돌아온 영들 리턴하지.
Guys, to the Kespa Cup for Hearthstone here. We did just have our first match, a quick 3-0 by Ghost over Caster. And we are going to be jumping into our second match of the night. It is going to be Time versus Sulky.
That's right. And this is going to be an interesting one. Time, a player who, no pun intended, has been a Korean Hearthstone pro since the beginning of Hearthstone's time, at the beginning of its inception or conception. I'm all over the place. I'm sorry. Fire me. I'm out. I quit. I retired. This is it. So we'll see if he can stand the test of time here in this best of five against Sugly.
Yeah. Hopefully we get into this in a short period of time. No more delays getting into this one. I think we should be all ready to go as the servers are up. The emergency maintenance did work out. And a good thing also that first series was a quick one because of those delays.
Definitely. So this is going to be another chance to take a look at some more snapshots of the meta. When you look at what we saw from Ghost in that previous best of five, with the exception of the Warrior deck, which really was quite unique from what I've seen and been watching, the rest of his decks were pretty standard. But what we saw from his opponent in Caster was something a bit strange and unusual. As we have a technician going to log us into the
joining,
game.
Joining the cast.
But anyways, our technician will get Valdez into the game. But more importantly, it feels like from the theme for today so far has been is the consistency of decks we've seen before that are more meta versus out-of-the-box kind of decks. Definitely the consistent decks are the better ones at this moment in time.
Yeah, for sure. I would expect that to go pretty much the same way as we continue on here. So the technician came over to make sure that I could join the game this time as I wasn't able to in the last series. So we'll see if I can get in. I should be able to.
Really quick, I'm going to run through these picks. Sogi and Time will both pick Shaman first. The ban for Time will be Warlock. Sogi will ban Rogue. Self-ban will be Druid for Time. And Sogi is going to self-ban Priest, which we haven't seen yet today. Same with the Druid. And we're going to have a Rogue Warrior for Time and Druid Warrior for Sogi. So the consistency of Warrior is real. And the Shaman picks as well. So we could have more mirror match action coming up in this best of five with the deck picks we have available, and we finally might see a glimpse of that Jade Druid that's so strong right now.
Yeah, I think we should be able to get into that one. I don't believe this is going to be a quick 3-0 like the last one was, as our Keck TV prediction did say this one was a bit closer, so that's kind of what I'm expecting here. They were right the first time.
Caster, that's definitely been, as he said in his interview, you guys watched during the commercial break, been a long time since he was a champion. But looking to come back here, and he's not out of this group yet. Whoever loses this, though, will be his opponent in the loser's match. The winner moves on to face Ghost. As this deck is getting set up.
Yeah, and both these guys exchanging smiles before the game does begin here, so as you guys know, this camera shot does mean we're going to be jumping into game number one of the series right now, so let's go ahead and do just that.
Here we go. Yeah.
Squeaked that one out there as soon as I could. So
Shaman Mirror.
Yeah, Shaman Mirror here. And this was the first pick for both of these players, so heavily favoring the Shaman coming into this tournament, it seems.
And Time's going to throw that flame wreath away, both of them. In fact, we'll keep the Maelstrom Portal and his Murgleton, whereas it's going to be Small Time Buccaneer and Jade Claws along with the Angry Totem. Totem Golem.
The Angry Totem.
Angry Totem.
Came to life.
He's permanently frowning. He was born that way. Sometimes he's happy. He just doesn't really show it. He's most happy when he gets played coined off of the second turn. But he still doesn't show it.
That's when everybody's happy except the guy who's playing against the Shaman.
All right, so it will be a Small-Time Buccaneer, and surprise, surprise, Patches the Pirate comes out along with him, and we'll do that extra one damage. Coining out Maelstrom here, not really an option. It will only remove Patches. We'll give him a one drop, but it could be simply clear the next turn, especially considering we have the Jade Claws. Another alternative play would just be to play Murgleton.
Yeah. It's kind of interesting. He would lose his totem power here. I don't believe any of these guys are running the 5-5 that lessens in cost whenever you play a totem, so no, it kind of makes sense.
Definitely not, and also not going to be running the Inspire Kodo. We'll go ahead and grab the Fire Blast here, and this is going to give him some more removal power in this mirror matchup. This is going to buff up the Small-Time Buccaneer. He will trade with Murgleton, and then he can use Patches. Considering not trading and going for face damage instead here, he knows that there's a possibility of that Maelstrom will actually use his face in order to clear to keep the Buccaneer healthy, which is a nice play, a nice counter to that Maelstrom portal on the other side of things. You see a South Sea Deckhand coming out. Can actually pair that later on with the Spirit Claws. He can use it right away if he wants to trade. He could potentially even trade the South Sea into the Small-Time Buccaneer and then kill the 1-1 Jade Golem. Alternatively, he could use the Maelstrom Portal and the Claws with Coin to get a 1-1 on the board after clearing. He's going to use the South Sea Deckhand instead.
Yeah,
get his own patches too, so he can clear both actually.
That's pretty cool. It's not bad. He needs to take back control of the board, which is mainly what he's trying to do here. Pretty decent start for Zolgudi. He'll do just that. He'll have his patches out.
All right. Well, this is definitely a time where the Totem Golem would be frowning, as even though it's a strong play here, it's a risky one to have him make it on the board. The J-Claws, it's awkward to use those against the 1-1. He definitely doesn't want to do that. He's going to save it. Does set him up to be able to Spirit Wolves next turn. Now we are going to see that Jade Lightning come out. So this is the reason why you don't want to play this, because you know that there's the potential of this or even a Lightning to come out and hit you. And then he trades, of course, with his Spirit Claws. So that's kind of a wasted turn. Now, like I said, he can drop the Spirit Wolves here. But with the Jade coming out, he's going to Maelstrom Portal instead. Oh, and such a lucky one drop with a Small-Time Buccaneer.
What?
So lucky. And he can actually South Sea Deckhand here as well. It's a risky play. But he's definitely going to consider that. He decides to save it. And with the Maelstrom here, it's definitely the right choice.
Especially against the Fire Blast, too. You just know it's only going to do 2 damage, and that's about it. So want to trade it to, or you want to keep it to trade a little bit later on and get a bit more value from that. So now a pretty strong board here, actually, for Sulku, even just with the Small-Time Buccaneer.
There's a lot of options for Time right now. I think the safest play is simply to just Fire Blast the Small-Time and Maelstrom. It'll still leave the Jade Claws there, but what other choice do you really have? I don't think there really is one. The only thing he loses is not Spirit Clawing again, which isn't an issue. I think Time is trying to think out right now his next few moves after this, because there's just simply no... Oh, man. Shapeshifter Zera is one of the worst one-drops he could get. But either way, he's still going to have... he could use some of that turn time to actually consider his next moves.
Sogi is just getting a bit better draws, I have to say, in this game. I mean, you look at the hand of time. He has a second Spirit Claws and two Lava Bursts, which are just going to sit in the hand doing nothing. I suppose he can now trade it for the Trog, but that's not exactly a good trade. And it's three mana, so it's not cheap either.
Wait, that's a good draw, the Lightning Bolt. But it's still not what he wants. What he really wants is Spell Power, which he lost with trading for the Fire Blast on turn one with Murgleton. A risk you have to take sometimes. We'll go ahead and Lightning Bolt the Tunnel Trog, and he may actually have to Lava Burst one of these wolves. The awkward situation that ensues. Oh, he could, in worst case scenario, which is so painful, but he might have to just Shapeshifter, Spirit Claws, Fire Blast, then Reclaw, which is also risky because his opponent could top deck an ooze or something, but he's going to do it to save mana. Man, this is just so Sugwe favored right now.
Yeah.
He still has the Jade Lightning. He's probably just going to Totem and play it safe.
Yeah,
he has
I like
no
that.
Reason to play any other cards.
I mean, he's seen those two cards in the hand of time. Because these are pros, they're counting the cards of the opposing player. And he's like, okay, he hasn't used either of those two cards. They've been sitting in his hand for so long. So what could they be? You know, if you're thinking about a Shaman, what two cards does he not want to use in this situation? It's, you know, Lava Burst. Perhaps a second Jade Lightning?
Yeah, it could be a Jade Lightning as well. Absolutely. Well, this Tunnel Trog will get the plus two from the overload of the Lava Burst.
This is terrible.
It's definitely not terrible, but it's bad. Oh, man. Faceless coming out here.
Yeah. The second cousin of Tasteless.
Yes.
Making its way into Hearthstone.
This is the stronger play than using the Jade because he doesn't have any stacks for his Jade Golems. Had he had a few stacks, perhaps he would have considered trading that for the Trog. This could be time's opportunity. Ugh, gets the Totem, or the Flame Totem though, Flame Tongue Totem coming out here. And he will probably just have to trade, which is unfortunate. He's so low on health. He's afraid. Well, the same thing you just described is how Sugwe knows that Time likely has direct damage he wouldn't want to use. Time is probably wondering, what direct damage does he have in his hand right now? So he's a little bit worried about his low health pool right now at 11. But I don't think he has any choice here.
It's such an awkward trade, too, because you do 5 damage with the Lava Burst, and then you have a Tunnel Trog that also has 5 damage. You have to trade that. You're not going to be... I suppose what you could do is Lava Burst face, and then... Totem, and then, you know.
Yeah, then you could have ace. You could have
7 damage Trog.
Yeah, 7 damage plus the 5 is 12 damage. Leaves you a 14. But he's going to clear your board after that, and you have no cards in hand. Oh, I think the better choice is to trade, but if he wants to go all in, he certainly can.
Oh, wow. He's going to Lava Burst the healing totem. Not even going face. Playing it literally as safe as possible.
Well, this is because he's afraid of Spell Power Totem coming out here, so he doesn't want the Spirit Claws to get bonus damage. Definitely a horrible situation for Time to have to make that decision. And I'll see what he gets. Not going to get the Spell Power he wanted, so won't be able to clear that without using the Jade. And he is considering waiting to use that Jade until he has lethal and playing the Tunnel Trog vanilla instead. He can't clear the totem. One South Sea deckhand was used. I don't believe the second one was, so that's something that could come out to come back to bite him. Ooh, it's just going to be a Totem Golem, though. Still a strong Totem Golem there.
It may force out the Jade Lightning here.
Yeah.
Just needs to keep control of that board. So we're still in a really nice spot, and oh boy. Can Jade Lightning get his own Totem Golem out there? Get another Totem as well.
Yeah. Does not get the Spell Power Totem again. Very important. Now we're going to have the 2-2 Golem coming out, so that's an issue. This may just simply be checkmate at this point. He's actually going to use his Spirit Claws to clear the Flame Totem. And what does Time top deck here? We'll never know. Okay, Maelstrom. Don't think that's going to save him.
You gotta do it. It's your own play. Your only play, rather.
Oh, he gets the 2-1. That does 1 damage on Battlecry. Doesn't get the Battlecry. Yeah, and he's gonna kill the healing totem. He's not dead yet. but actually he might be now. Yes, he is exactly lethal with the Jade Lightning. And that will be game over. So we will take game number one, eliminating his Shaman from the hero pool, or the class pool.
Pretty close one there. You know, Titan did get a bit behind towards the middle of that game, but Sogu wasn't, you know, dominating him. It wasn't the caster versus ghost series we saw previously. And Titan, we saw both players actually taking out their Shamans for the first game, so I wouldn't be surprised if Titan just goes ahead and uses it again.
Certainly a possibility. Warrior is available too, so if he's expecting Warrior, he may bring his own. We will see. But, you know, with mirror matchups like that, it's so frustrating to lose your first deck like that, because suddenly your opponent's just got the better cards on the better end of things, when those decks were, from our, you know, estimation, just looking from the outside in, nearly identical. And that is just how Hearthstone goes sometimes. Sometimes you get unlucky. But it seems like things are running pretty smooth here now in terms of our connection to Battle.net. So happy about that one.
Yeah. These players are playing a little bit slower than the previous two players, but it makes sense. There's a lot of small decisions, but very hard decisions to make when you're playing a Mirror Shaman matchup. So guys, that was game number one. Game number two is beginning right now between Sogwi and Time.
Maldez, it will be Shaman again here for Time, but we finally get to see our very first Jade Druid. So we bring it out here already. We'll only keep his roots. And we are starting this one off. Mulligan's out.
Yeah, and Time actually didn't even mulligan anything. He just went straight with what he was given. Small-time Buccaneer, Totem Golem. Faceless.
Living Roots coming out here to eliminate that small-time Buccaneer, making sure he never goes full-time. Totem Golem coming out. This is a bit of a frustrating start for Sogwi. He can absolutely bounce back. Getting this Innervate actually would allow him to potentially Innervate out a Druid of the Claw with the coin. Now, if he draws out the Gate Drake Spirit, it's not really worth it at this point in time. Looks like he will just simply go ahead and Innervate out that Druid of the Claw. It's a very expensive move, but in this case, there's no way to deal with it right now for Time, so it ends up paying off.
Yeah, perhaps if he had gotten Spirit Claws, he could have, you know, used the Pirate in his hand, South Sea deckhand, to go and trade there, but he would be trading everything, so it's going to be interesting to see what Time does here. Does he just play it slow, maybe just drop out a totem, or maybe flood the board with his minions and just wait? Because he wants to make sure he can get that faceless on the next turn.
There's not a whole lot of argument against dropping out the Trog. Dropping out the South Sea, though, you might want to hold on to it. The Trog, of course, will get buffed by the Faceless going into the next turn, so I think you definitely want that out. The only other option is to Totem here, which wouldn't get any benefit. If you get the Taunt Totem, that does buy you an extra turn of the Druid of the Claw trading in bear form, but the problem is that you're a 1 in 4 chance of even getting that Taunt Totem. I think it's definitely best to Trog here. Oh, he's going to risk it, and he does not get the Taunt. Ouch.
Yeah, you can see he waited until the end of the rope, so definitely a not easy decision there for Time.
And now Sogwi can actually just attack up here and get 4 attack, clear with the Totem Golem. He may even want to save it. The world is his oyster now because he has those two options. To keep the Druid of the Claw healthy would be useful in most cases against super aggro. It's not going to help him against the Faceless that he doesn't yet know is coming next.
The other thing he can do is save the Feral Rage for the armor if he just wants to try to survive here and trade that out. So he's going to save it. Just go and attack in two patches, clear that Totem Golem as well, and just hope that Time doesn't have a Lightning Bolt. And at the same time, it's going into turn four against the Shaman, so...
Jade Lightning comes out here. That's going to spend his turn. He's going to get the 1-1 Jade Golem, not the scariest thing in the world just yet. Okay, Jade Spirit gets played. And this is when we start to see the Jade Druid build. He only has one Jade card right now, but later on with the card draw he has in this deck, he's already having two card draws with his Azure Drake, so he's going to get more and more powerful. Now this next turn for Sugwi is going to be awkward with the Flame Wreath coming out right now, because Swipe can no longer be used to clear this, considering that he just traded into the 1-1, got the heal back, and it looks like he's just going to have that awkward Drake draw turn. Not much else he can do here efficiently. And this game could run away with itself, with Time. Ooh. Oh, the world is his oyster. He's just going to go ahead and play the second Flame Wreath.
That's going to buff up the Trog, allow it to trade with the Drake, and now he has two 7-7s on the board against a Druid. That's specifically against a Druid, as Druids don't have all that much removal. It's very hard for Sogwi to deal with this right now. And another kind of awkward turn here. He's trying to draw into something. He does get the Innervate.
It's just not going to be useful yet. Now, if he saves the Innervate, he can later on have some really powerful synergy with the Fandral with his armor and attack at the same time. But
he actually has lethal.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
Yes, he does with South Sea.
And there you go.
There you go. So Time will tie this up 1-1. I was going to try to make a case where he could get some armor a little bit later on, but... goes down. Had too slow of a start there with that Jade Druid. And so Shaman removed now from both players in this series going 1-1.
Yeah. I guess there's a reason why both players wanted to play that. Seems pretty strong right now, specifically against what each player brought to the table in terms of decks.
Yeah, we have this meta now where basically, classes with weapons have so much power with all the synergy that you can grab with patches, and also, of course, the early game small-time Buccaneer. I mean, with those two cards together, basically having weapons becomes a good idea. Then suddenly you have a weapon, the Jade Claws, that give you a 1-1 that's also a token you've got on the board for extra damage, for extra trading potential. And what's interesting is in the Druid deck, you try to explode the Jades and get to an insurmountable amount of them. But what happens with the Shaman version is they're just extra damage for you. You're never really trying to get a 6-6 Jade.
Yeah.
It's just bonus.
Very true. Bonus on bonus. So guys, let's jump into game number three right now. Tied up 1-1 so far between Time and Sogwi.
Coming out here, actually, versus, again, that Jade Druid. And, ooh, that's a rough hand. On the side of the Rogue, it's not the best hand ever, but definitely one that you can flex into. All right, ooh, he's got both of his Jade cards. He'll probably shuffle here. Ooh, it's just going to actually get the tempo, go for the tempo variation.
Wants to start building up those Jades very fast.
He does have Aya and another Jade Spirit in hand, so that's definitely something he could bank on going forward.
Yeah.
Okay, he's going to save the second one. If you use both, then you're never going to have any shuffled in your deck, so basically that Auctioneer that he has in his hand becomes a dead card as well, because you use that to power out in the late game all of your Jades.
very true. So just going to be a slow start for this matchup. I think right now Time is thinking, do I want to just throw out the SI7 agent, or do I want to save it for potential board clear?
He could also counterfeit coin out the tomb pillager, which would be a strong play. There's without coin, there's no way to swipe, and if he has to use swipe, it's actually a good trade on the turn. You replace the coin with the tomb pillager's coin, so something he's definitely considering here. If the tomb pillager doesn't get removed, it gets insane value, and that's what he's going to go for there. For those new to this expansion, the counterfeit coin is now a class card for Rogue, and it is identical to the coin in every way except art. So,
and name, yes. I suppose. So, as you were saying, it's going to get a lot of value, that Tomb Pillager, if it cannot be removed. And no swipe on the side of our Druid player, Sulky. He's got an awkward turn ahead of himself. Does he just wait?
I think he may just have to Jade Spirit here. And start rolling that ball. If he waits another turn, he can coin out the Druid of the Claw. Okay, he's going to play the 2-2, which will be instantly removed, no doubt, by the backstab in his opponent's hand. And now he has no more Jade Idols, so he won't be able to shuffle. That's a bit of a scary situation.
Look at another that draw! One. Unbelievable, gets the second Tomb Pillager.
This starts to feel like our first best of five. There's the backstab clear. The only thing he really needs now is a if he has the Cold Blood, then he can have a fantastic next turn, and it'll be almost exactly the same as what we've already witnessed before. Aya Black Pal going to come out here. This is what he was looking for earlier, is hopefully I can get Aya out for the Jade Spirit, and then suddenly I can start to run away with this game with the Jade Golems. A 3-3 here, of course, will become a 4-4 when Aya is killed. Well, in this case, she's sapped, though.
Yeah, he's not really scared about the Jade. You know, the Jade Golem's getting out of hand because he just has so much momentum. If he could just clear board and continue doing damage, he could win the game in 2-3 turns. So I like the play to just sap that and continue getting a ton of face damage here.
Ooh, Wild Growth not going to be helpful at all. Honestly, I'm not sure what would be, though, at this point for Sugui.
Well, he can buy himself a turn with the Druid of the Claw, kind of. It'll only stop the damage of one of those Tomb Pillagers.
If he coins out Aya again, then she still will have the upgraded Golem. I believe it's 4-4 now.
Yeah.
And then that could become a 5-5. The problem is that he's going to be dealing with 4 health. In fact, he has lethal. If he doesn't play Druid of the Claw, Time will kill him. He does decide to play that. He takes the safer route here. Oh. Auctioneer probably save that for the follow-up Conceal. This is actually an awkward turn for Time. If he wants to get the full value from Eviscerate, he'll have to play Conceal first, which would be counterintuitive. And he'll still have to run in the SI7 agent.
He could kill one of the Tomb Pillagers, get a coin, and then gadgets in, coin, Conceal. Yep. But then he would have to trade something else or find one damage somewhere else. Which is really where the problem lies. But he is going to go for that. I think it's just too much value. You're going to draw 2 cards for sure. And if you draw into one of your preps, you're on a roll. So let's see what he draws here.
Okay, Edwin. Not going to be able to play that this turn, unfortunately. But with Conceal, it does set up a follow-up turn to play him next turn. There's no way the adjacent can be removed now. And he's still going to trade in the SI7. In fact, not even going to keep the Tomb Pillager concealed. He wants to run with that momentum.
Huh. Interesting. I guess you wanted to get the draw first, 100%.
And here comes Aya.
Worried about that being concealed.
And 9. This is lethal. He does not have any way of stopping it. It's going to be the Eviscerate has the choice of lethal. 5 more damage. Tomb Pillager. Time will go on to match point here. Not enough. Again, with Sugui out of luck with this Druid. Just ramping up a bit too slow with the Jades.
Yeah, and Time getting a fantastic role in the beginning of that game. Getting the counterfeit coin into the first Tomb Pillager and then top decking the second one on turn 4. He just had way too much board control very early on and was able to run away with that game. So Time goes up 2-1. And he only does have one deck left.
Yeah, this is a very scary moment for Sugby, and I'd say he has to win with the Druid no matter what versus the next one, so he might just play it again because he has to win with this matchup no matter what, which is the scary part when you're down like this. Because if you show your other two decks first and then play with the Druid, you're kind of changing your own mindset. It's a really awkward place to be. He has two decks he has to win with, his Druid and his last remaining, which escapes him. Might actually be Rogue as well. And
I think it's Warrior.
That's right,
for both these players, Warrior, they still have Warrior left over, so.
So do you really want to play a Mirror? And you have to, even if you win it, you'll have to actually win again with your Druid.
So guys, let's jump into game number four right now. Time versus Sugby. Going head to head.
Here's the Warrior from time. Sugby, again, going to stick with the Druid. I like this mentality. Go 3 for 3. Oh! Double innervate, but nothing to innervate. As we see it as a Dragon Warrior, not the Aggro Pirate Warrior, but a meta choice here by time. You can see Alex Strauss's champion, Fierce Monkey. Ooh. And even a Ragnaros, so it's definitely the control variation here of the Dragon Warrior.
He mulliganed his Twilight Guardian, so he can't get the extra attack on his Alexstrasza's champion. So, kind of a interesting mulligan there. I suppose he was hoping to get a dragon in the next couple of draws, but he does not.
That's unfortunate. Well, technically speaking, he could actually coin out the Ancient of War with the innervates. Don't think he would like to do that. Just going to play the safer, slower Wrath here. Gonna 3 damage it to maintain board control. He doesn't need draws per se right now. The awkward thing for Sugly is with this, that he doesn't have anything he can innervate into with the Jades, as his animation seems to be bugged here for a moment. But
I hope it is just for a moment, and he's not glowing the entire match.
It's happened to me before. Wild Growth here is not really, it's just simply not going to be good. This is an unfortunate hand. He's going to go ahead and perhaps even charge this Druid of the Claw. Nope, wants to go for the Taunt. It's been a terrible choice to charge it, but this is going to give him a more beefy minion. It's going to help protect his 1-1s. Blood to Ikor. Oh my god, this is a super control deck. In fact, nothing about this is Mean Streets of Gadgetzan. It's straight from One Night in Karazhan. Mm-hmm. Well, I guess this is just going to keep happening, guys. I'm sorry. The Jade Icon is his first Jade draw this game. This is the best shot he's had so far with this Jade Druid. 1-1's going to run into the Slime. The Hero Power up. And a Wild Growth. The Jade Icon not required yet. It doesn't have any other cards to pair with it right now, so there's no reason to shuffle it, because it's going to make his draws worse, and there's no reason to play it, because he's just going to get a 1-1.
He still has so much ramp in his hand with the second Innervate and the coin. Next turn, he can coin the Ancient of War, and then have his Innervate for something else.
Yeah. If he drew Auctioneer, this game could have been opened up completely. Of course, he did not, so still in favor massively of time right now with the cards he has in hand. And dealing with this Ancient of War is going to be frustrating. But he's nearly there, so he's just going to go ahead and start working on it.
Yeah, as you said, just doing 3 damage and letting his minions sit out there, not going to attack into it just yet. Gonna let Sugby do the work.
Jade Spirit here, totally useless as well, as Sugby just is not having any luck. The Spirit, of course, is going to give him an empty Mana Crystal, which is the last thing he needs right now. And again, a 1-1. He doesn't have enough damage without actually hero powering to kill both. You could run the Ancient of War into one, run the 1-1, then go for the Roots into the Roots damage, 2 damage plus hero power to clear both. It is possible you'd be left with a 5-2 on the board. That would be not ideal, but he's just going to have to do it, I guess. Starts the ramp into the golems with this. Oh man, this is so painful.
See if he does clear this. Looks like he will. Yeah, that's what we're saying. Just gonna get the 2 damage with Living Roots.
See if we're gonna desperately drop out the second one. The awkward thing about that, too, is if he top decks next turn a Gadgetzon, Auctioneer, then he's gonna regret this choice.
He's gonna look a lot more frustrated than he does now.
Yep.
So, you guys can only imagine the level of frustration. Ooh, what a draw. He gets enough damage to clear the 5-2 now.
He doesn't have enough mana for Rag. That's going to be his follow-up play. But he can just drop this in the Fierce Monk. Actually, I'm going to go for the Twilight Dragon instead. Which is also frustrating to deal with. Sogui has no answer for that.
I was looking to see if Sogui had any facial expression after that.
Okay, this is the Jade Behemoth. If he gets a good draw next turn and Rag doesn't get a good hit, then he could come back in this game. I've played a lot of games where I'm in a situation like this and suddenly get Auctioneer. And the whole game turns around.
Yeah, very true.
It's
possible. If you get the draws, you know, one after another. He actually attacks in there because he wants that Twilight Guardian to have 3 health. But here comes Rag.
Oh, man. Golden Ragnaros, mind you. The most terrifying version.
Boy. You get an extra 10%, but unfortunately it hits the second best target.
Okay, we're starting to get the Jades rampant. Alright, 4-4. Still a lot of targets for Ragnaros. Again, he's looking for that card draw. Even a Wrath, you know, that he could top deck here would potentially propel him into a comeback. Ooh. Romash Hellscream drawn, though. He will actually play it. This can clear the 4-4 and gives him a crazy 10-5. This means Rags hits are better as well, and don't forget patches.
Yeah. Always never forget patches.
Seriously, like, don't forget. A lot of people end turn before he comes out because they even freeze in the deck. I've done it before. I've killed him.
Another Jade Behemoth, but it's only going to give him, you know, more minions on the board. There's no board clear for him. He can't deal with Gromish. He can't deal with Rag.
He will survive one more turn with this play. But now, if after he loses a second Jade Behemoth, and he's already used one Druid of the Claw, he's not going to have any more taunts. And I don't think he'll be able to survive no matter what he draws. Even if he has a 6-6, a 7-7, a 9-9, and a 10-10, I don't know if he comes back in this game at this point. It's not looking very optimistic. Fierce Monkey going to help protect against those said Jades. And we just see the Frothing Berserker come out here, which will get buffed. Oh, he's just going to empty hand. He knows he's that far ahead.
Let's see where Rag does decide to hit this time. He's going to go face with the Rusty Hook. Here comes Rag. It goes right for the 5-5. There's just no answer for Sogui here. Nourish, he can draw some cards.
This is the card draw he wanted a long time ago. But, there's Aya. Can't even play it. Swipe he wanted earlier, he can't have. And that will be a concede.
I suppose you swipe and swipe the Frothing Berserker and cry yourself to sleep, because that's basically all you can do.
Okay. It's lethal no matter what. So he's... And that's with what's on board. So it's, and there's nothing in hand, so he knows it's over. He's going to play it out. He's going to have time. Hit the face. There's Alexstrasza's champion. Not going to get the charge. He has 8 damage, 11 damage, 12 damage. And if Rag doesn't hit face, he lives, right? That's the only thing he can hope for. That's why he plays Aya here. But let me think about this. Let me calculate this. He has... If he kills Aya, then he can clear the 6-6 with his Frothing Berserker. So if he uses the Fierce Monkey to kill Aya, he clears the 6-6 with the Frothing, which will be 7-4 at that time. He could go face with the Frothing after trading with Aya, but that'll leave a 6-6 and 7-7 on the board, either which could be killed by Rag, and if it misses those, then it kills Sogui anyways. So there's a lot to think about, actually, with this turn. as I wasn't calculating if Aya would actually come out and spawn a minion, I was only thinking of her as one body, so it's not technically lethal.
Gonna trade to the 6-6.
This is the better way.
There's both of those, but 9 damage now.
So if he kills Aya, that's great. If he hits base, he wins. 50-50. Here we go.
See where it goes. It kills Aya.
Sugly's last chance. He's got a swipe he has to use. And he's going to have an 8-8 and a 9-9.
It's actually not a bad position. Now, for Sugly, I mean, he can get a bunch of these Jade Golems out. He can clear the rag, and now there's only a 2-2 on board.
This is actually empty in the hand earlier. May have been... I guess it's the only thing he could have done. It was not like if he didn't empty his hand, he'd be in a better position, but a game that was nearly certainly lost. Now potentially back in the hands of Sugly. Draconoid Crusher here going to come out as a 9-9 with 4 health remaining.
That may force Sugly to trade here in a bit of an awkward spot.
Oh, that's a great draw. Sick draw here. That Nourish comes out.
Now he's going to get 5 more cards, or 3 more cards, rather. And
he has his second idol here. So he can get a 9-9 and a 10-10 and trade. He will survive. He will survive.
I think that's the way to go.
So he plays the... In fact, he doesn't even really need to do both, because he could save one for later and get more health, just in case he runs like Road Strike or something. He's really scared about that. He didn't be dead no matter what, I guess. Let's see what he decides to do here. The armor is the safe choice, I guess. But if he has any direct damage, he loses anyway. There's no card that's going to give him one more damage that the armor would have actually been significant for. He's hoping for no direct damage.
Oh, man.
The Ikor. The comeback is real.
He's not dead yet. Now he basically has to use this to force another minion on board that needs to be cleared.
Yeah, because he still has 24 health and only 20 damage on the board right now. If he top decks swipe, he has lethal. 19 plus 5, 24 exactly. I don't have exactly enough mana to do it. Only takes 9 mana. Oh my god. This is a crazy close game. Alright, let's see what he gets.
What is he gonna get here?
Another Drake, but he could top deck the swipe! He could top deck the swipe!
Is it gonna happen?
Oh, that's 4 damage! But it's not 5! He needs 5!
But he can power up.
Oh, he can hero power, yeah. He has just enough mana.
That's lethal.
That's lethal.
He's just making sure 100%, but he got it.
Oh man, that's the worst feeling ever. There you go. Barrel Rage, Hero Power, and we are going to a Game 5.
Unbelievable set of plays here from Sugly as time. Getting a bit unlucky with the rag. If the rag just hit base, he would have won the game and this would be over. But now we're going to Game 5. We're going to have our mirror. Oh, man.
Yeah, had he played the... If he had not played the Aya as well, had he taken a different option, a lethal would have been there too. And suddenly we have a series here and we are going to have Warrior versus Warrior. The question is, will it be mirrored or will it be Aggro Warrior versus what we've seen already from Time? And Time's Warrior, I think, actually kind of has a slight edge over the Aggro Warrior with the taunts he's running. And the removal he has. He even has Blood to Ikor. This is going to be a tough uphill battle for somebody, but he's already won 2 now. This is pretty exciting.
It really is. We're going to game number 5. And I mean, I have the deck list here of Sogui and what his warrior looks like. I'm not going to spoil it, but it's pretty interesting as well. You guys are going to be going into game number 5 right now. Let's do it. The warrior mirror between Time and Sogui.
Here go. The final match of this best of five will be the Warrior Mirror. So we finally find success with that Jade Druid. I'm wondering if that wants to keep that Twilight or not. Some real decision making going on here.
That's the micro mechanics aspect of Hearthstone, how fast you can click and unclick your mulligans.
Alright, so these decks are fairly similar to each other.
Right off the top, yeah. See what he wants to go for here. It is going to be Fire Blast picked up. Ooh, nice draws for both players here, right off the top.
No weapon, but he will get patches. That's going to be something annoying. That time we'll have to deal with. That small time Buccaneer, if he gets buffed though. Nice. Comes Alexstrasza's champion with the Drake in hand, will get buffed. And so even though it was a nice draw, it doesn't end up working out. Oh, as you can tell here, Sugwi's Warrior also has the Curator in it, which further shows you just how much control it is. So neither of these Warrior decks are the Pirate Aggro, which seems to be falling off quite a bit in this tournament, I'd say. We'll see less and less of it going forward. It's good on the ladder, but when it comes to tournament play, everyone's decks are a little bit more well-rounded, I'd say, right now.
Yeah, it seems that way. And
oh man, this is terrible, because simply now Time can drop his own Frothing and then buff it up like crazy while clearing the Frothing of Sugwi.
Yeah, the Alexstrasza's champion really was the tide turner so far in this game. Really being the champion here for Time. So here we go, as you were saying, this is the only play.
This is the insane play.
Yeah.
Having a 6-4 on turn 3 while clearing your opponent's board. Pretty solid. It's only going to get stronger from here.
What do you do now? Fairy Dragon? That's not much.
I mean, yeah, you have to. The weapon isn't going to do anything. A small time Buccaneer was on the board. It would be nice to have that turn earlier. I didn't know he was going to get cleared. And now he can play. Well, he has a lot of options. He can play his own Fairy Dragon. He can Korkron. Korkron's probably not the choice because you can't remove the dragon. He could Fairy Dragon himself, and then... Oh, he is going to go for that. Okay, just going to start threatening some face damage. See, this ends up being good for Sugwi, because now he's just going to get free trades. Only taking 10 damage, which is not something a warrior is too concerned about, especially because he has Infinity, and he has armor.
It was an interesting choice to go face, you know? I thought he might have just dropped the second Berserker, and then traded with the dragon because, you know, it's turn 4 against a warrior. There's a chance he has Korkron or some other answer.
And he gets half the damage of the Korkron anyways because the Frothing Berserker will get +2 more when you trade into the Drake, or excuse me, the dragon anyways, the Fairy Dragon. He does have a nice follow-up here with the Fierce Monkey.
He's really fierce.
He's so fierce. Look how fierce he is with that shield. It's like... That's how he's modeled it after the taunt icon that goes around his portrait.
I didn't even know he had a shield.
No, like a moon on it for some reason. Or maybe, no, that's a banana, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Could be a moon.
You would have to think that's a banana.
Maybe, maybe he's a moonkey, sort of a monkey. All right.
According to Blizzard, though, monkeys don't like bananas. They like peanut butter, so.
That has been a trend, yeah, that we've seen.
Yeah.
And other titles.
So, perhaps it is a moon.
Well, right now, there's a lot of tough choices he made for Time. He doesn't know what's in hand of Sugwi. He has been able to suss out, of course, at this point that it's a pretty much a mirror matchup. The question is, what's in hand? Because it could really be anything. And it's hard to predict, so that's what he's trying to think of right now. He has a lot of face damage he can threaten. In fact, has 15 he can threaten by running in the Frothing Berserker, the Drake, the Korkron Elite, and Fire Blasting Face. Alternatively, he can protect his Frothing Berserker and even trade the Drake into the 2-2. Make his Frothing an 8-4 and hit Face with it. That's the conservative play. And that's what he's going to do. Twilight comes out. Going to go Face with the Drake instead of trading. Get 2 extra damage. And this is a scary place right now for Sugwi.
Yeah, he doesn't really have an answer here.
Time was hoping for everything that you see on screen right now. I hope Sogi doesn't really have an answer for this. I hope he's got some big drops that aren't going to clear my board and he's going to get overwhelmed.
Look at that. He plays his Drake and that's it.
The concede. That's it.
Time does take the win, so a quick mirror there, ending on turn 7 as Time, with that Alex Strauss's champion, taking the early lead in that game and cleaning it up. So he will be going on to the winner's match to face off against Ghost. Sogi will be going down to the loser's match to face off against Caster.
I feel like Caster is probably feeling a little bit stressed out after watching how close those games were, though, and the decks that Sogi brought seem to be, again, more towards that middle-of-the-road type consistent deck that can kind of run against anything, whereas Caster's decks seem to be very niche in nature, very unique, with the Murloc deck coming out. He's had unlucky draws.
Yeah.
So I want to favor Ghost going into the winner's match, but anything could happen.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see if we see any of the other decks that got banned or see how these two players match up in terms of the decks that they did bring. Maybe we'll see some different bans, some different decks being played. Maybe get to see some Warlock. That's really what I want to see.
Yeah, some of that Reno Lock would be great. Something that's really popular right now on the ladder and for top players in Europe and NA who have been streaming, like Savich, for example, is very much into the Reno. Doing both Reno Priest and Warlock. We've been playing some C'Thun Warlock. It was on the front page of Reddit today. Him and the Epic Sax guy going at it. But that's basically the gist of things, guys. We're going to take a look at this replay again. As you guys can see, tough time here for Sogi in game two. It was a pretty close match at the beginning, but things started to run away from him.
Yeah, and Sogi, you know, he got that first win. Then we see him eventually get a couple of games squeaked out from underneath him by Time. And he makes some incredible comeback moves, especially in game number 4 with the Druid. I want to see those highlights.
But here we go. Insanely close game. He has nothing but an Innervate in hand. Rag hits the 3-3. Gives him a chance, keeps his taunt alive. And he gets Gromash. He survives through that as well.
You see all this, and it's like, how does he make it through this? But he does.
Yeah, never just concede. And he does barely survive through there.
You guys didn't really get to see that, but
yeah. But you probably were watching the whole time, and you probably remember what happens. As overwhelming Jades come out eventually to seal the deal. Yeah. A 9-9 and a 10-10.
Yeah, and then he gets the Feral Rage off the top from the Drake, and just barely enough exact lethal, but he does lose in the end. So, guys, we're going to take a quick break before we go into the winner's match. Stay tuned.
Next